one, Social and Economic Justice Committee's third annual Black History Month event. This year's theme is Black History to Black Futures. I want to thank you all for coming out on a Friday evening. Well, coming out virtually on a Friday evening to spend this evening celebrating Black history, but celebrating also Black futures and where we're going, Black and brown people together, arm in arm with allies, to make sure that our futures are bright. And as we all know, when we lift up the Black and brown, everyone else is lifted up as well. So I want to welcome you, and I am so appreciative of everyone who has joined the broadcast this evening. So next, we do have a full agenda for this evening, but I just wanted to flash back to the video that was just played. Those are your social and economic justice officers. We call it SEJ for short. And as you can see, we have been very busy over the last year since our last Black History event, helping to organize other work sites to be part of unions, fighting for social and economic justice changes, as well as fighting for the rights of Black and brown people who are habitually trampled over by law enforcement and government and some of the many things that have just been going on. So tonight we have hosting the event, our SEJ officers, and this is something that we're very, very proud of. We've been doing it for 3 years now. And it's so crazy to say that we've been doing it for 3 years. I can't even believe that it's been 3 years. But we have had a series of very successful events, and we've had some of our other committee members and other committees and caucuses within SEIU Local 10-1 who have also stepped forward and held their own Black History Month events. And so I am very, very proud of our committees, our caucuses, and our SEJ officers who have put so much blood, sweat, tears, dedication into being part of the social and economic justice of not only SEIU, not only our state, but countrywide. We have had fights here in California that have echoed all the way to Washington. So I am very, very proud and honored to be your MC for this evening. My name is Nicole Christian. I am the Social and Economic Justice Secretary, and we will move right into this evening's agenda. So next up, we have the Black National Anthem.
Lift every voice and sing until earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmony, harmony on the knees of liberty. Let our rejoicing arise, 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 high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing this rising sun, this rising song of march on until victory is won.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. That song is so powerful. It is so unbelievably humbling. And I know many of us on this, we've heard it a bunch of times, but it's still so very beautiful and so very powerful. So next up, we have a film. I'm not sure if any of you are familiar with it. Most of you should be. It's called The Uncomfortable Truth. We are going to show the film and then have a panel discussion afterwards. So if you'll look at the bottom of your screen, there is the Q&A function. You can click that and type your question in either now, during the movie, or after the movie. And our panelists, Dante King and Stefania Searcy, will answer those questions for you. But if you have any questions, please use the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen to list those questions for us, and we will get to them. Please enjoy this movie. It is going to be uncomfortable for some, but it's also going to be validation for others. Please enjoy.
So a few years ago, there was this friend of mine, and you know, like, Facebook, right, friend, and he makes this post, and this image pops up, and it's him holding this black licorice gummy bear, and he's like, yeah, right, you know, I found it, I can't believe it, you know, a black licorice gummy bear, it's just like the other ones, except for it jumps higher. I write, wow, really? And he says, what, Loki, it's not racist, it's a positive stereotype. Now, before I could tell him there's no such thing as a positive stereotype, one of his buddies jumps in and says, yeah, and the yellow ones are better at math. That becomes a cue for all of his friends, his like-minded friends, to just to pile on. It just gets worse and just starts going downhill. And that's when I realize, I'm like, wow, these guys are racist and they don't even know it. And you know, that's why I'm making this film. Because doing nothing's not an option.
But really, it's all of us who must overcome the crippling legacy of bigotry and injustice. And we shall overcome.
Quickly as I could gather this information together, she was gone. I've never found another mention of Mary Harris ever again.
That was truly powerful. There was so much information, so much pain. It's very striking that white supremacy came out of fear of losing something that everyone tries to have. Security, safety, wealth for their family. Very powerful. So right now we're going to take a brief bio break. Let everyone get up and stretch their legs. Please, again, if you have any questions, use the chat function at the bottom of the screen where it says Q&A. And we will be back at 7:10. 10-minute break, 7:10. We will. All right. Thank you, thank you, thank you for that music supplied by our sister and our program director, SEJ officer, Miss Alyssa Jones Garner. Thank you so much for sharing your music with us. There she is. All right. We hope everyone has returned, had a moment to stretch their legs and feel that motion again, get that blood flowing, get all excited for our next portion of our program. Now, we did watch The Uncomfortable Truth. We actually watched the shortened version so that we wouldn't keep you online for 3 hours watching a movie and having a discussion. But you are able to buy the full version and watch it at length. There's more information in the full version. So please check it out if you have the opportunity to do so. So to introduce our panelists this evening, I am very proud to introduce our panelists because this lady is phenomenal, beautiful, stylish, intelligent, passionate, and a serious dynamite of a person. It has been wonderful getting to know her. Her name is Sefania Searcy. For the past 20 years, Sefania has dedicated her career to electing progressive champions for working people up and down the ballot and cultivating the next generation of organizers and political operatives. Sefania serves currently as the Deputy Director for Program and Talent at the SEIU International, where she is responsible for the implementation of staff development and racial justice work in the union's Together We Rise department. Prior to this role, Sefania oversaw SEIU International's national member politics political programs. In this role, she partnered with local SEIU unions on the implementation of the union's national political strategy in an effort to build long-term, sustainable political programs that connect race, class, and other issues important to members to the political fights necessary to win on our issues. Additionally, Sefania oversees the Member Candidate Pipeline Network, which cultivates the interest, education, and preparation of SEIU members who desire to run for office. Now, remember that for all of you would-be politicians out there, Ms. Sefania got the hookup. You got to contact her. A prolific facilitator of numerous programs in the union and her community, Sefania is a strong voice for progressive issues, dedicating her life's work to leading as an advocate in the fights for economic, social, and racial justice, civil and human rights, equity, and inclusion. Sefania, will you come off and say a couple words, please?
Good evening to the beautiful, fabulous members of SEIU Local 10 to 1. It is my absolute honor to be in this space with all of you tonight. I am a fan of this local. I am a fan of all of you. And I give great praise to the Creator for the inspiration and the fortitude that all of you have to continue to fight for a better life, both at the bargaining table and in our communities. It's the moment that we are in right now is truly extraordinary. We watched this incredible documentary of the Uncomfortable Truth, and what it revealed for all of us is that the same very thing, the foundation upon this country was built of white supremacy, is still alive and well today. And I am grateful for your bravery for being on the front lines to say, we as a collective union family are looking to bust this down and create equity for all. once and for all. Glad to be here.
Thank you, Stefania. Beautiful as always. Our other panelists for this evening, Mr. King is Mr. Dante King, who I am also very proud and very pleased that I have the ability and opportunity to introduce to you today. Dante is a native San Franciscan. He is an author, historian, scholar, a thought leader, facilitator, a coach. He has worked in the Human Resources Department and for the City and County of San Francisco, which is how I was fortunate enough to come across him. He has done some amazing, amazing work for racial equity within the workplace and within the community. He specializes in the implementation of anti-racist practice, organizational development, and change. This includes racial equity, racial repair, racial relief, and inclusion strategies. Dante also specializes in bias capacity building with more than 20 years of professional and academic experience. It has been my pleasure to work very closely with Dante in some of his trainings. We think that as Black people, we have racial justice on lock. We do not. When someone like Dante walks into your circle and opens your eyes to the expansive world that you have in front of you and the things that you can accomplish in this brown skin, it empowers you in a way I had never known before. So I'm going to stop gushing over him. And Dante, if you would come off mute and say a few words, please.
Sure. So first off, thank you, Nicole. All I can really say to that is wow. And I just want to say I'm grateful to be here too. Nice to meet you, Stefania. And I see a lot of people that I know in this space because of some of the work and actions that we've taken together in the city context. So I see Gail Birdsong, and I saw Champagne Brown on here earlier. I saw Harold. So it's nice to be in the space with all of you, many of you I consider like family to me. And I'm excited to be here to have this discussion. So thank you.
Thank you, Dante. Appreciate you being here this evening. Our moderator for the panel discussion is Ms. Angela Thomas. Ms. Angela is staff working with the Social and Economic Justice Committee for SEIU Local 10-1. She is a historian in her own right with a full library in her house. I have seen it. It is a gorgeous full library. Ms. Angela, are you there? There she is. Ms. Angela, would you say a couple words about yourself and then lead us into moderating the discussion this evening?
Oh, okay. There's not a whole lot to say about me. I'm the granddaughter of a sharecropper. And I think that sums up why and how all of this started for me. And I'm very glad all of you guys are here. And I don't want to take up any more time on me. I want to get to the meat of this. We've already done half of it. I'm so glad to see Dante, who I didn't know I knew until I saw him. And Stefania, I've heard such wonderful things about you that I just want to drink it in. And I'm sitting up here, you're probably hearing all this ding ding, because the babies is trying to tell me something that I probably didn't do or did do or something. But that's it. So I believe Dante is going to start first.
Yes. So we do have one comment in the Q&A. And then Ms. Angela has some questions for you. Each of you will have a turn to answer those questions. So the comment in the Q&A is that the bottom line of racism is sin and a matter of right and wrong regardless. Dante.
So you want me to respond to that? So I say this, it depends on which side you're on. I believe as a Black person that it's very wrong because we've suffered the rage of anti-Blackness against us always in this country, right? But if you are a white person and you belong to that organization of people who whose previous members of that organization enacted cultural terrorism against Indigenous people, against Black people, and you benefit from that today, and you don't question that, or you're fine with benefiting from it, then you may not believe that it's a sin. You may not believe that it is as sinful or as bad or as serious as those that are impacted by it and have been impacted by it. And the one thing I'll say before I stop, I wrote this book that you see behind me. It's entitled The 400-Year Holocaust, White America's Legal, Psychopathic, and Sociopathic Black Genocide and the Revolt Against Critical Race Theory. And one of the words, if you were listening to the Black man speak in the video, The Uncomfortable Truth, he used the word psychosis. He used the word psychosis because it is a psychosis. And I think what we have to understand, and can I share an example really quickly of what I'm talking about? Because I have some slides that I want to share. I wrote my book because I teach a curriculum about this that I've developed. I think what we have to understand is that if you look at the legal process or laws and the ways in which they evolved and how they developed and what they contained as they were developing, and I'll just give you one example, right? It's a conditioning process to not only white people, but to everyone in American society in terms of how one can treat Black people. And so they gave some examples in the video, in The Uncomfortable Truth. I'm gonna give you a few examples. So you've got in May 1870, Congress passing the Enforcement Acts of 1870 and 1871. These acts protected Black voters by providing the use of federal oversight and supervision of elections. The 1871 Act was called the Ku Klux Klan Act, and it was passed in 1871, and it authorized President Grant the use of federal troops and provided that racial terrorism against Black people was illegal because you had the initial surge, if you will, of white extremist groups that were enacting violence. You've also got John Langston Mercer and Charles Sumner who introduced the Civil Rights Act. And this is an enforcement act to protect all citizens in their civil and legal rights, giving them equal treatment in public accommodations, public transportation, and to prohibit exclusion from jury service. But in 1876, in the United States v. Cruikshank, the U.S. Supreme Court that the 14th Amendment was not designed to protect individuals against the actions of other individuals. And this was regarding a case of 150 Black men who were organizing to determine how they were going to vote. And in Colfax, Louisiana, you had over 300 white men and people who launched an attack against them, started shooting in the building where they were organizing, right? So the U.S. Supreme Court decided that those acts of violence against them was not a violation of the 14th Amendment. So therefore, Black people were not protected against violence from white people under the 14th Amendment. That's what this ruling essentially did. You've also got concerning the 1875 Act that I just shared in public accommodations, the Supreme Court of the United States ruling in 1883 that the Congress has no right. What they say is that the 13th Amendment merely abolishes slavery and that the 14th Amendment does not give Congress the power to outlaw private acts of racial discrimination. So it provides white people with the cultural foundational framework to begin discriminating against Black people in any way they deem fit or necessary. You've also got in United States v. Harris, and this is very important, the Supreme Court dismisses indictments against a Tennessee sheriff and his accomplices who were accused of attacking four Black men and killing one. The court held that that Ku Klux Klan Act that I just referenced, passed in 1871, that that act was unconstitutional because the 14th Amendment limited Congress to taking remedial steps against state action that violated the 14th Amendment and applied only to acts by states, not to acts of individuals. So you've got, and they mentioned this period between 1883 and the 1960s, thousands and thousands of people who are lynched by rope, by gun, by castration, and then being burned. All of this was facilitated by the federal government. It was facilitated by the Supreme Court of the United States. And no one stepped in to do anything different. So it's not just an evolution of cultural terrorism because white people developed a dislike for Black people, but white people have been trained and conditioned in this way. And so anti-Blackness is not just about whites against Blacks, but it's about a cultural evolution of an orientation that has been raised against Black people.
I say, Dante, I'm so appreciative of you lifting that up and connecting the dots in that way, because what it does is that it gives the setup a lot of times in the union and in other spaces in the community. We hear so much, and there's so much talk about white supremacy culture. And what Dante just laid out is that we are the one nation under God where permission was given to 1,000% unequivocally make Black people less than, undervalued, as a matter of fact, non-valued, persona non grata in existence in relation to white folks in the founding of a country that they stole because it didn't belong to them anyway. So if you begin now to just trace the history, right? They left Britain because of the king's rule. There is, as we would say in the church, right? I grew up in the Pentecostal church. I grew up Church of God in Christ. And in the church, there's a scripture in Ephesians that talks about principalities, powers, rulers of darkness of the world, spiritual wickedness in high places, okay? Think of a principality as something that rules and governs over a big thing. Okay, white supremacy culture is the principality that rules over the very existence of America. So the only way to tear down a structure like that, it is through not just the conversations that we're having here and the education and information that Dante is sharing, but it's continuing to share the stories and lift up the stories of the uncomfortable truth. America was never designed for Black people to succeed in this country. And every single example of success that we have had over the course of the existence in this country, 402, almost 3 years, there has been an intention to tear it down and to destroy the success of Black people, okay? We had it on Black Wall Street. They burned it down. In the labor movement, they couldn't take white folks and Black folks calling each other brothers and sisters. So this man named Vance Muse couldn't handle it. And it was because of that, that right to work was even birthed. All because they didn't like the fact that white folks and Black folks were calling each other brother and sister. The system was never designed for Black people to advance in this country. It was never designed that way.
I appreciate you so much, my sister.
I appreciate you. You was over here giving like, Lord have mercy, I need it.
All right, y'all can't shout yet. We got to get to the next question.
Yes, okay.
We're going to shout later. Okay. Because I like that shouting myself, okay?
Yes.
Okay, Sister Danielle says, I frequently hear whites explain that their family was historically correct or has suffered in familiar context because their heritage was that they came to the U.S. as white, or-ish, indentured servant. What is a polite way to explain that having that in your history is still not on a comparative level to someone coming from a family history of Black slavery? It is akin to the my family never owned slaves syndrome. I'm asking Don to go first.
So I think a few things come up for me when I hear that. I think it's important to understand that indentureships, which were certificates that people signed on to that ranged from roughly anywhere from 7 to sometimes 10 years, 7 to 9 typically, but it could be up to 10 years. If the contract was sold, it could be upwards of like 11, 12, 13 years. And yet at the end of those indentures, those individuals were given resources, specifically guns and gunpowder. But what is extremely important to amplify is that they would be given acreages of land. Initially, the average acreage that they would be provided after their terms of indenture were up, 50 acres of land. So at the end of a 7-year term of indentureship where you lived on someone's land, you've labored for them, you've worked a job, and in exchange for working that job, you were provided food and beverage, housing, all of that would be laid out on the indenture contract. I actually have some examples of some of those. But at the end of that, even though you've been compensated through food, boarding, at the end of that indentureship, you're released from that contract, from that term of service, and you're provided with a substantial bonus in land. And that process was, again, legislated. These are laws, these are statutes that were in place, right? That's very different than people who were either stolen from a region where they lived comfortably. And typically, a lot of the people who were stolen out of Africa or kidnapped by some Africans and then traded to Europeans, because that was happening initially, those individuals were people of high skill and ability. Many of these people were great. They had substantial skills in farming, in agriculture, in building weaponry. These were not just people that were sitting around like waiting to be kidnapped because they were unintellectual or they didn't have any ability, right? But it's a different context when you're stolen from where you come from and then you're forced into not plantations. I want us to use a different language. I'm going to invite all of you to use another framing for this. It's not that they're put on plantations. These people are imprisoned.
Yes.
And they're held in captivity in labor camps, which are prison camps. But the prisons are controlled by individual owners rather than communal ownership, right? And those people are not only enslaved for life, but then Anglo-white Europeans begin to build legislation. And I have some examples of this too that I can pull up that says that hereditarily, if the baby is being born to a Black woman, it is enslaved for life. If it's being born to a Black male, it is enslaved for life. That's an entirely different context. Does that make sense? Well, I'm asking, but I can't hear you all. I hope that makes sense, sis.
All right, Sister Stefania.
You know, I'm just taking this all in, and literally I'm leaping in my heart right now, because there are a couple of things that come to mind for me on this question that was just raised and what you just lifted up, Dante. And the way that I sum it up, specific to the question of how do you politely say, right? Like, how do you politely tell people that it's no comparison? This is what I think Whoopi Goldberg was attempting to do a few weeks back, right? She got suspended for 2 weeks because she did misspeak about the way in which Hitler viewed our Jewish brothers and sisters. She did misspeak. Hitler did see our Jewish brothers and sisters as a different race. But sit that aside, because Hitler was an egregious, and what happened during the Holocaust was absolutely horrific and traumatic. The point that Whoopi was lifting up beyond her misspeaking, the greater point was when a Black person and a white person enter a room, a Black man or a white man, they will not know if that white person is gay, straight, Irish, Polish, English. They won't know when they see them. But when they see that Black person, they see Black. And it's truly this imagery of Black and white. So to the question of how do you politely say this? The polite way is, if you and I enter the room together, they can make an assumption based on what they see about us in gender. There's a set of assumptions. But what's unequivocally clear is that I'm Black and they are white. And that is clear based on what you see. And when we think about the oppressions that Black people have endured in America, it has been solely based on the color of our skin. The Bible was used to enslave people in the name of Jesus. It was used to justify the actions of what slave masters did to our people. And they lifted that up in the documentary. It's like Black people and Black men in particular were looked at as a person that would rape and kill, rape their women and kill their people. When in reality, it was a guilty conscience, because that is what they were doing to us. You know, and so I just want to, when I think about the polite way to frame it, it's really based on what people see and how the experience of what people saw before any words were uttered caused a race of people to treat Black people in that manner.
Okay. Yeah. And can I just say one thing to that? I'm going to ask you all, I'm sharing about, I think, 10 books is what I'm providing.
Yes.
For the union to be passed out. And I'm actually going to put the link to my book over in the chat so that you all can share this with your friends and family. Because, and even for those of you that may not get a book or whatever, please buy it and support it. But I wrote this book for Black people. I think it's important for us to be able to not only understand our history, but reframe it. So I'm going to give a few examples of what I'm talking about. And you can simply even share this video with people. Keep this video, because I'm sharing some examples of the things that I cover in my book, right? But this 1662 act concerning literally a Black woman who went to court in 1655 and sued for her freedom because they were trying to extend her indenture. Her father was actually an Englishman. Mm-hmm. They were trying to extend her indenture so that she would be enslaved for life. And she happened to have a white common law husband who acted as her attorney, and they went to court because the law at the time read that any child belonging to an English or Christian father, they carry the identity of the dad, of the paternal parent. So under English common principle, English people could not be enslaved. And also you have Christians that could not be enslaved. But in 1662, you have the House of Burgesses, which is the first governing body ever established in the colony of Virginia. And they say that whereas some doubts have arisen, whether children got by any Englishman upon a Negro woman should be slave or free, be it therefore enacted and declared by this present Grand Assembly that all children born in this country shall be held, bond or free, only according to the condition of the mother.
Mm.
So if you're born to a white woman, an English woman who is free, the child is gonna be free. But if you're born to a black mother that is enslaved, then the child inherits the condition of enslavement based on this one law. I'm gonna share another example that's pretty vile, but white women, when rape laws were erected throughout the states, now we're talking about the United States of America, not colonialism. That's you right. Got by statute, rape laws that protect white women only. Black women are exempted from being raped.
Yeah.
So in essence, you've got the United States, state by state by state, enacting laws that legislate through statutes and laws that Black women can be raped, that it is legal to rape Black women, even when courses went to case. Even when cases went to court. You've got judges, such as this judge here in Missouri, yes. 1855.
Yes.
Who basically says that this Black young girl who was being raped for more than 5 years, she had had two children by her rapist, that it was just intercourse. And he gives instruction to the jury to convict her of murder, even though she was trying to defend herself against him and had sought help from his daughters. She sought help from other people. No one would help her. And he says, he describes the rape as intercourse. If Newsom was in the habit of having intercourse with the defendant, who was this? I mean, it's beyond vile. And I think we have to understand, we have to not only understand, we have to interrogate. And this is what the Black man was saying in the documentary, the psychology behind it. These people were conditioned because they had evil, vile, diabolical thoughts about Black people and what it means to be Black. And not only did they erect and create their own identity out of those principles and that foundation, they constructed an entire culture that functions on that principle. So it's not just about white supremacy, it's about anti-Blackness. It's an aversion. It is an aversion to anyone, not only who is Black, but who is perceived and or interpreted
as black.
Because as long as they didn't think you were Black, you were fine. And so when I named my book, the 400-year Holocaust, White America's Legal Psychopathic and Sociopathic Black Genocide, I mean that.
Yes.
I mean that. And if I have time, I'm going to share a few quotes with you from some scholars whose work I lift up in my book.
Yes.
Okay. Now, we're going to do a couple more questions because really, y'all, we're supposed to be wrapping up, but I think we'll get in trouble. So here is another question from Letty, and it says, how can we confront anti-Black racism in other communities of color?
Ooh.
Okay.
Mm. Loaded.
Go ahead, sis.
That's a loaded question, but it's a real question. It is a real question. And some examples of that, and I always say one of the first places when you're talking about confronting anti-Black racism among other communities of color is starting at the colorism conversation. The colorism conversation, again, another tactic by white folks, right, that created this whole psychological ingraining into our people of
lighter skin versus darker skin, placing higher value on anything that's closer to white and lesser value on anything that's closer to darker. Like, the I'm trying to keep myself from cussing, but you know, it's literally this diabolical, as Dante puts it, diabolical psychological ingrainment that has been a part of our culture around colorism. And a lot of times, as a matter of fact, I was watching most recently another documentary, and in the documentary there was a woman who had asked a question. She was biracial, and she had asked the question of, so is the onus on lighter skinned people to reaffirm, recommit, challenge, you know, the conversation around colorism with darker skinned brothers and sisters? And what I say to that is, a conversation is a conversation. First of all of this is messy. It is all messy, but it was messy from the very start by the people who created the mess. Okay, the white folks who created the mess, the white folks that instilled anti-Black racism. So I always encourage people, when people are looking for a start of how are we dealing with it in our communities, you know, colorism is a place that, you know, you can really begin to tear down walls around. There's also differences and nuances as it relates to various segments of culture in the African diaspora, Afro-Caribbean, you know, Afro-Latino. There is a number of Afro-Creole, like there's a number of different cultural dynamics that speaks to that as well. All of us working through our own internal challenges around anti-Blackness and the way in which the home culture, where a number of our family members come from, have even taught, you know, have even treated, I hear a lot in the Latino community, that a darker skinned Latino is treated differently than, you know, one that's fairer skinned. And then, you know, a lot of the different dynamics and conversations that we've had with each other, how we're viewed with each other, how Black people have viewed Latinos and Latinos have viewed Blacks. And, you know, like it is just, it's a conversation that is necessary to work with each other and talk to each other about, you know, what we experience in the places where we come from. And even though the it's unfortunate that the sins of the fathers are still tormenting and haunting us today, but I believe that we are a people and a generation right now where we can begin to start having these kinds of uncomfortable conversations to figure out how we work through this mess that was created over the last 400 years to get us on a path of healing and loving each other and embracing each other holistically.
I'm going to say like my mama say, my, my, my.
Can I also answer Thank that you. Question?
Yes. Okay. If you can do it in a minute.
Can you give me two?
I can give you two.
Thank you, Nicole.
You know you ask and I say yes.
I love you. I want to say this. Number one, it starts with education, because Black people, along with other people of color, are living in a delusion, and we're living in a delusion that has been built and constructed by white people. I'm going to share a few slides and I'm going to run through a few quotes. It'll be very quick. And I want to give a trigger warning for this initial slide. Mm-hmm. I think it scales in totality what the experience of Black women have been. And this is in the spirit of my grandmother, my great grandmother, who experienced this trauma. Mm. Okay. So I'm going to make a few points and then that'll be it. Anti-Black female human sex trafficking, rape, pedophilia, and prostitution are white moral and economic foundational institutions.
Yeah.
The American cultural evolutionary norms that were legally sanctioned legislatively and judicially for more than 300 years. These institutions constitute and represent a core tenet represented in white psychology, white identity, white morality, white legality, white power, privilege, and culture, while also conveying a complete and total disconnectedness from Black humanity, the Black body, and a proclivity towards anti-Black abuse and terror. Dr. Cheryl Harris says the concept of whiteness was premised on white supremacy rather than mere difference. She says whiteness as a theoretical construct evolved for the very purpose of racial exclusion. Thus, the concept of whiteness is built on both exclusion and racial subjugation. So it's not just about having the best, being the best. It's about, I also need to subjugate and marginalize you. Dr. Alvin Poussaint in 1971 says, I think we have to establish that racism, white racism, is a mental illness. Mm-hmm. Many white social scientists would like to define racism as something that is normal, as a cultural variant. As long as we approach it that way, we really don't deal with the pathology of racism itself. It's like saying that cancer, because a lot of people have it in this society, is somehow normal. Dr. Bobby Wright, and this is the last one that I'll share. He says, in their relationship with the Black race, whites are psychopaths, and their behavior represents an underlying biologically transmitted proclivity with roots deep in their evolutionary history. The psychopath is an individual who is constantly in conflict with other persons or groups. He is unable to experience guilt, is completely selfish and callous, and has a total disregard for the rights of others. One of the best methods that can be used to measure the psychopathic traits of the white race is observing and analyzing their universal overt behaviors and attitudes towards Blacks. Psychopaths simply ignore the concept of right and wrong. Mm-hmm. By ignoring this trait in the white race, the lack of ethical and moral development, Blacks have made and are still making a tragic mistake in basing the worldwide Black liberation movement on moral suasion. It is pathological for Blacks to keep attempting to use moral suasion on a people who have no morality, where race is the variable. And so the last point that I'll make is that if people of color have accepted this country and this culture and history and the way that it's told as right, as this is the way that it is, as normal, as truth, they are living in a delusion. And so they are more prone to be anti-Black without empathy and without any idea that there's a different reality because of what they've been taught. And so they need to be educated first initially. But I think even with education, it's a long shot.
Oh yeah.
Oh my. Whenever my mother is overwhelmed with the word of God, whenever she is overcome by someone who speaks so eloquently of a situation that is so barbaric, my is what she says. Mm-hmm. And Stefania and Dante, I'm so full, my cup is running over. I thank you so much. You have answered questions. You have brought your passion and your activism to this situation, to this whole subject. You have made it so that even though there are some of us uncomfortable, you have made that space for us to have that real conversation. And I want to honestly, from the bottom of my heart, down to my toes, thank you so much for being here tonight. Thank you so much for agreeing to be on our panel. We appreciate you more than you know. And you will be back. So keep your emails the same so that we can get in contact with you.
Thank you.
All right, I'm going to turn it over to Alyssa. She is going to do a raffle. We have 9 books to raffle off.
Oh, nice. And one of the books we've reserved for Ms. Stefania as a thank you and a show of our appreciation for your presence here. Dante is an extremely powerful presenter. I've had the honor of being taught, being mentored by Dante. And I'm fortunate enough to call him my friend. And you've also taken myself and my sisters under your wing. You provided us with guidance, with friendship, with mentorship, and most importantly, with sisterhood. And I am so humbled to be in both of your presence and eternally grateful that you have shared this space with our brothers and sisters here. And I know that they will take what they've learned here this evening and they will do good. They will ask more questions. They will stand up as we in this union stand up. They will fight, and with the knowledge they have gained from both of you, they will stand in that word. They will stand for what is right. Now, before I cry, I'm going to do the raffle and have a couple of trivia questions from a game called Black Card Revoked. It's a game that was created by Black people. So always want to patronize Black-owned businesses. So having a trivia game created by Black people is always fun. And
let's explain the rules really quickly. So all for everyone who is attending this evening, please use the chat function. If you open the chat, you'll have to answer. It'll choose everyone. So make sure that you are using the chat function to answer the question. The first person with the correct answer wins a copy of Dante's book. So please, again, make sure as soon as Alyssa finishes reading the question, you put your answer in the chat and make sure that you have it selected for everyone so we can all see it. And I will announce the winner as soon as I see the first correct answer.
Right. Now, this is a fun question. It is a trivia question, a television trivia question, and it's multiple choice. So, how many fights did the Fresh Prince get into before his mom got scared? Is it A, 5, B, 1, C, 2, or D, 3. I see Charmaine got in there.
Yes.
Quickly.
Charmaine Brown, thank you for your correct answer. You are the first to and the first person to win a copy of Dante's book this evening. If you would please message the host and panelists with your email address, and we will make sure to contact you to get you that book. Thank you again. Ms. Charmaine Brown has won the first book.
Can I just say hi to Jesse too? Jesse Stanton. Sorry.
Of course.
Okay, here's the next one. And this one, if you know the Divine Nine, you should do well in this one. Okay. Which historically Black sorority was founded first? Was it A, Delta Sigma Theta, B, Zeta Phi Beta, C, Alpha Kappa Alpha, or D, Sigma Gamma Rho?
Okay, the first person to answer was Miss Champagne Brown, our resident queen, and hers is her answer is Alpha Kappa Alpha.
And she is correct.
Woohoo! Our second book won for this evening, won by our own queen, Miss Champagne Brown. Champagne, I have your email, so I will contact you about how to get you the copy of the book.
All right, here's another movie trivia question this time. Okay, approximately how long did Sophia have to fight? Was it A, 5 minutes, B, all night long, C, all her life, or D, never? There's Karen.
Yes.
They are good.
I got to do it, y'all. I got to do it. All my life. I had to do it. I couldn't resist. I'm sorry.
All right. The
winner. It's like if you are Black, you know every one of these.
Line upon line, precept upon precept.
The winner of the third book of Dante's, Miss Karen Williams. Miss Williams, if you would please email the hosts and chat, put in the chat to the hosts and panelists your email address so that we can contact you about getting you the book. All right, number four.
All right, now this is a Black history question. Now, before he was a member of the Nation of Islam, what was Malcolm X called? Was it A, Young Slim, B, Red, C, Slim, or D, Detroit Red?
All right, do you see the answer, Alyssa?
Put D first.
Sure. The first person to say Red was...
No, Detroit Red.
No one got it.
Linda Martin got it.
I see.
There we go.
I had to go back. It was flying by, okay? All right, Miss Linda Martin, you have won book number four for correctly answering Detroit Red. If you will please chat the hosts and panelists with your email address, we will contact you as to how to get you the book. Number five.
All right, I secretly really love this question. It's a television trivia question. Jerome from Martin is a player from A, Detroit, B, Harlem, C, Chicago, or D, the Himalayas.
All right, we have Gail Birdsong with A.
Nope.
Ooh, okay.
The correct answer is the Himalayas.
I mean, y'all don't get that right. Y'all don't know who Romy Rome is. I'm the player from the Himalayas.
That's right, sis. Okay. So two people did put it, though.
Said you're Roman.
Which letter was the Himalayas?
D.
Okay, D? So Karen, you already got a book. So we got to give it to Derek.
So we're going to give it to Derek Boutte. Derek Boutte is our social and economic justice chair, and he has won book number five of Dante's 400-Year Holocaust. Derek, I got your email. I will contact you shortly to find out how to get you the book. All right. Question number six.
All righty. Now, another history question. Put your thinking caps on. What year was interracial marriage legalized in the U.S.? Was it A, 1964, B, 1952, C, 1973, or D, 1967?
All right, the first person to answer was Gail, and she chose A.
And she was wrong. Oh. Actually, the person who got it right is Kristen Loomis. It was actually in 1967.
Yeah.
All right, Miss Kristen Loomis, congratulations. You have won book number six. Kristen, if you would please chat the host and panelists and give us your email address, we will contact you regarding getting you that book. Question seven.
All right, question seven. This is another history question. And you all should know this, hint, hint, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, because it addresses something that happened earlier today. Now, who wrote Lift Every Voice and Sing, aka the Negro National Anthem? Was it A, Langston Hughes, B, James Weldon Johnson, C, Booker T. Washington, or D, Maya Angelou?
All right, the first person to answer is Gail Birdsong with B.
And she is correct.
Yay! You finally won a book!
James Weldon Johnson.
Thank you so much. All right. Gail has won book number 7. Alyssa, question number 8.
Righty. Let's see. We'll do a history question. In what city did Rosa Parks refuse to move to the back of the bus? Was it A, Tuskegee, Alabama? B, Montgomery, Alabama? C, Birmingham, Alabama? Or D, Jackson, Mississippi?
Okay, so Linda Martin already won a book. So on to David Williams. He was the first to answer with B.
All right, and you are correct.
Yay,
Montgomery, Alabama. David.
All right, David Williams, you have won book number 8 of Dante King's book.
And just a fun fact for all of you, she was actually not the first Black woman to actually be thrown off of a bus for not giving up her seat. I believe there were actually 9 other Black women that took that stance. Unfortunately, they did not fit the aesthetic narrative, and they weren't seen as sympathetic. I believe 2 of them were single mothers. One of them was fairly young, and it was not believed that the public would be galvanized to support them. But when they did take that stand and Rosa Parks became that figurehead for this movement, that's when things started to take shape and people started to galvanize around the movement. So just a little, you know, little history tip.
Thank you so much.
I don't know if you all saw Barbershop. I think it was Barbershop 2. But that actually was the best line. I mean, Cedric the Entertainer did it very comical, and he kind of took it over the top. But that was the best line he said. When he said, Rosa Parks wasn't the first woman to sit down, but she got all the spotlight because she worked for the NAACP, and that's how she got all the spotlight. So that's one of the best lines in Barbershop.
All right, our last book of the evening. Alyssa, question number 9.
Okay, one more history question. All right, which historically Black fraternity was the last to be admitted to the Divine Nine? Was it A, Omega Psi Phi, B, Iota Phi Theta, C, Kappa Alpha Psi, or D, Phi Beta Sigma?
All right, so Champagne already won a book. So the next person to answer first, Leticia Zamudio, and she guessed Omega.
Nope, wrong. Oh.
The next person is Nancy Atwell, and she guessed D.
Nope.
Next person to guess was Robbie White, and their guess was A.
Nope.
Okay, so A and D are not it. Let's find somebody who picked a different one. Annette Montiel guessed option C.
No.
Anybody out there guess B? Okay, Nancy Atwell guessed B.
I was going to say, was I out? Wasn't I out of the last one to come in?
It was.
Yeah, that's what
it
I thought.
It was.
Okay.
And actually, my mentor, Robert Clark, was one of the founding members of that fraternity.
All right.
And he started that branch. And he actually helped start that branch, I believe, at SF State and in Chicago as well.
We got Black history all over the place. All right, Miss Nancy Atwell, you won our last book for the evening, book number 9. Please chat the hosts and panelists, and please enter your email so that we can contact you about how best to get you that book. Thank you, Alyssa. Those were very entertaining. I really like that. We may have to incorporate that again.
And it disappeared. It's called Black Card Revolt. And
can you put that in the chat for everyone?
Sure.
Thank you, my love.
And please support this game. It's a game about Black culture created by Black people, small Black business owners. And we want to do our best to make sure that we're recirculating everything back into the community.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. All right. We have come to the end of our program. So I will ask our social and economic justice chair, Mr. Derek Boutte, please come on camera and thank us out into the night.
Wow. Beautiful event. Beautiful event. I would like to thank you all so much for all of your participation and just being here with us for this social and economic justice event. First of all, let me thank SEIU 1021 for all of the support it always gives us as members within our local. I'd like to thank our SEJ committee, our officers, for their resilient work that our officers do on a consistent basis for our membership. I would also like to give a special thanks to our panelists that came on here and gave us so much insight, so much education, and just so much of their hearts just pouring out to each and every one of us. So I want to thank you all for that. And I want to thank all of our SCJ committees and our members in our committees, our chairs, our officers of our committees. I just want to thank you all for all of the work that you guys do, all of the work you do to empower our communities, all the work you do within our workplaces, all the work you do within our society as a whole. And let's just continue fighting the unjust that needs to be fought. I want for everyone to have a blessed night. Please be safe. Love your families, but most importantly, love yourselves. And have a good evening. And thank you all for being here this night.
Thank you, Brother Derek.
Good night, everyone.
Thank you, Brother Derek. Good night, all.